It's more than 90 years since we last played Tchaikovsky's Iolanta here in Stockholm at the Royal Swedish Opera. Now, at last, we have this production here again. And I'm so happy to have you here, the director of this production, Sergey Novikov from Helicon Opera in Moscow, and the conductor, John Fiore. So nice welcome. So John Fiore, I start with you. Welcome back, because you've been here before.
Yes.
Twice, actually.
Yes.
Eugene Onegin and Andrea Chenier.
Right.
Yes, and you are working all around the world. We could say you are a guest conductor at the foremost opera houses in Europe and United States.
Yeah.
Also working with some symphonic repertory. So, and you were in Norway for a couple of years.
I was music director in Oslo for 6 years.
Yes, so we have been speaking some Norwegian here.
Indeed.
Yeah. if we compare Iolanta with the two other operas by Tchaikovsky that we know much better, Eugene Onegin and Dame of Spades, what can we say about the characteristics of Iolanta?
Well, Iolanta is his last opera. Actually, it came right after Queen of Spades. And to compare them to Onegin and Queen of Spades, I'd say it's more on the lyrical side, a little more similar to Onegin, I'd say, because Queen of Spades gets extremely dramatic and has a much darker kind of quality to it. For me, it's interesting because he wrote it pretty much the same time he was writing The Nutcracker, which is, of course, his most famous work. And I don't know if everybody knows that Nutcracker was premiered on the same night as Iolanta. So they did Iolanta first, and then they did the Nutcracker. And for me, there's a lot of similarity in the music between the two pieces. I always get a little kick out of it, because every so often you'll hear a passage that sounds like something that would be in the Nutcracker. The big duet at the end has this big orchestral play out. It sounds like the pas de deux in the ballet at the end. I'd expect for Iolanta to do some turns and, you know, with the prince and then brump at the end. And there's also when Vaudemont, the tenor, and the baritone Robert come in, the music sounds very much like the Mouse King music in the first act of The Nutcracker. It's just, I mean, the colors of it and the sound of it is very similar, because he wrote it basically at the same time.
Yeah, and it's his last opera as
yes.
well.
Yes,
can you sort of feel that in any way?
Well, I mean, who knows if he knew at the time that he wouldn't be living very much longer, because he was, I think, dead within a year after the premiere, no?
Right.
So, who knows?
But he died due to the infection, so.
Right, right. So, I mean, I don't think he had a sense that he was, you know, which you might sense from the Pathetic Symphony, you might sense that something's approaching, but yeah. Not in this opera. This opera is actually very positive, and it's very full of light. That's the whole, of course, part of the story, which Sergei will explain. But actually, the sound of the orchestra, the feeling of the music is very much on the bright side, and optimistic and hopeful.
Yeah. You staged this production in Moscow at Helicon Opera. It was three years ago, yes. And we had it in our plans for, you know, 2020, but then, of course, this pandemic came. For us, Iolanta is quite an unusual work in the repertoire. We did it here many, many years ago. Last time in 1929, first time in 1893.
I didn't see that one, did you?
No, me neither.
No. But in Russia, it's not the case, of course. What place has Iolanta in the repertoire of Russian opera houses?
Well, I would say Iolanta is one of the schlagers among Tchaikovsky productions, among Tchaikovsky operas, because here we listen to his music when he's on the peak of his career as an opera composer. You know, he wasn't always successful opera composer. For example, his first operas, such as Voivoda and Undina, he even burnt them out. And then the third opera, Opryčnik, it is a strange Russian word. I would translate this in English like exceptionist. So it's about the era of Ivan the Terrible. It was more or less successful, but Tchaikovsky wasn't satisfied with the music. And when he created Iolanta already, he asked the library of Mariinsky Theater to send him his manuscript of this musical score to renovate it as far as he was already on the peak of his power as a musical composer. And then Cherevichky again, he wasn't satisfied, and he rewrote it. And then, you know, some miracle happens because he's creating some musical scenes for his students to pass exam in the conservatory. And among this, combining these musical scenes, we suddenly get one of his masterpieces, Eugene Onegin. And starting from this period, he understands that he can come out of the pressure of rules and canons and musical traditions of 18th century. And he starts create his opera masterpiece, such as Mazeppa, Queen of Spades, and Iolanta, of course. And the subject of Iolanta, the story of Iolanta, for him is not the new one as well, because after Eugene Onegin, he creates a really great opera of a big form, of big shape, opera Maid of Orleans.
Wonderful, too.
Yeah.
And he is creating lyrics himself for this opera. So he's deeply inside of the characters, of the history, of all the matters and the consequences. So he understands the logic of all this history. And Iolanta, by the way, is part of the story because King René, her father, he got acquainted with Jeanne d'Arc in the castle of Duke de Lorraine when René was 19 years old. And when Jeanne d'Arc says, please give me your son, knights and horses, and they will lead me to the court of the Dauphin of Chinon. Son, it means King René, our King René from Iolanta. So it was the part of the story he was already very well, deeply inside of the character. So he came again to this French history in Iolanta. But it was not maybe his main idea. Actually, we see in the documents that he writes in one of his letters to his brother that I would create such an opera, everybody will cry. And so we have it.
Have you, music. Have you ever done Maid of Orleans and Iolanta together?
No, I haven't.
That would be rather interesting, don't you
yeah,
think?
Yeah, we may one day.
Could be an idea for us.
Someday, yeah. Someday.
Talking about the other Tchaikovsky operas, it reminds me that outside of certain countries like Russia or the Czech Republic, that people know maybe one or two operas. They know, and everyone knows Onegin. Mm-hmm. And some people know the Queen of Spades less, I think. Onegin's the one that's played the most.
The
just like Dvorak, everybody knows Rusalka, but he wrote many operas.
Yeah, right.
Smetana too, The Bartered Bride gets played everywhere, but nobody knows about these other operas that are played all the time in Prague and places like that.
We need singers or directors or conductors who sort of become ambassadors
right,
for the music.
But this is why it's so wonderful to do a piece like this, which is definitely Tchaikovsky at the height of his powers, writing at an incredibly high level, and it's a very accessible piece, and it's a piece that one can really take in right away because the music is so overpoweringly beautiful.
Yeah. But what can we say about the vocal writing? Because there are so many fantastic arias in this
they
piece.
Are, yes. But I think that Tchaikovsky writes extremely well for the voice. I think that was clear even in early operas. I mean, Onegin's very well written for singers, and I think singers like to do it. There are some wonderful...
Sorry to interrupt you, because Onegin, it was his musical score composed for students. So
right, but even there...
He was in favor of to help them to pass the vocal exams.
Yeah, but on the other... You have to understand voices and singers to do that well. And not all composers, I mean, always understand the voice well. I mean, opera composers, of course, the famous ones who wrote all the great operas do.
Yeah.
And of course, all that tradition comes from Italian music from before, when so many composers admire the bel canto period of, you know, Bellini and Donizetti and those people who wrote so beautifully for voice. But yes, and there are wonderful showpieces that, you know, standalone arias. The King's is the first one. I mean, Iolanta has a very short arioso at the beginning, which is very kind of an internal, personal kind of piece about how she feels about life and what she's missing in her life. And you feel this longing in the music. But a full developed aria, her father's aria, is the first big dramatic piece which starts out with this incredible trumpet fanfare before it goes into the recitative and the very somber, self-searching aria. And then the contrast is the Robert aria, the baritone aria about Matilda, which is just amazing, full of energy and color and enthusiasm. And you think this Matilda must be some fantastic woman, no? Because it, this aria is
she's not
amazing.
There, yeah.
She's not in the the opera, but the, I mean, I'd love somebody to write a piece like that about me.
Yeah.
No?
Right?
Yeah.
And then, of course, then we have the big duet, which is the centerpiece of the whole thing. Mm. When Vaudemont and Iolanta get to know each other and discover things about each other. And it's like a big, it's almost like a music drama, I'd say, that scene. Because a lot of it's recitative, discovering each other. She discovers, of course, that she's lacking something, the thing that she was wondering about at the beginning. Something's missing, and I don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. And finally, once we've gotten through all the recitative section, which is dramatic recitative, there's a nice G major duet, which is, you know, a nice, clear form with a clear theme and a kind of development section and another clear theme and ending up together in this big wash of G major, which for me is, again, sounds a little like the pas de deux and the Nutcracker.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it happens near the end of the opera, yeah, too, like the pas de deux happens near the end of the Nutcracker ballet.
That melody.
Oh, yeah, I think of that more as a, yeah, there's a mysterious aria with the Moorish doctor.
Yes,
I don't think of it, I think that's part of like the whole scene, but yes, it is a set piece, mm, which also has been done by itself.
Yeah, they are like hits, you know, these melodies, yeah, because they stick in the head. You have them in the head.
It's interesting that you mentioned that one, because the Ibn Hajj aria, the Moorish doctor who eventually cures her, mm, is extremely mysterious music. It
yes,
really is.
Yeah,
it's,
yeah,
it's somewhat not otherworldly.
Like anything, yeah.
It doesn't sound like the rest of the piece, the way it's scored, the way it, you know, the effects in it. It's basically the same melodic line repeated over and over, but the orchestration changes, more and more colors come in, things happen, and it starts piano and it grows all the way to this huge fortissimo at the end, and then pulls back again.
Yeah. The story, I mean, the story is it's based on a Danish play by Henrik Hertz, and it's set in the Middle Ages with knights and castles. But you have done it more up to date. It's a story about our time also. It's a bit classical, but also very up to date. So please tell us something about your interpretation. What can this story tell us today?
It is a story up to date, or maybe about near future, because we see the closed castle where some girls and ladies live, totally cut off other world, staying just with their gadgets and devices. And we understand that their duty is to cure and take care of some Iolanta, which is very well educated, very well brought up, and actually she is self-sufficient, but she understands that she lacks some feeling, something. So she has to know something more about her human being. Actually, she is just 17 years old, so it is regular for every young woman. So, but we understand that her blindness is not a disaster for her, because she feels herself perfectly well and she understands what's staying around, and she goes freely right and left, forward and back, because it is her own world, and she doesn't feel that she can do something material, but she understands the lack of some spiritual. And what we see around here, we see people who are involved in their gadgets, do mm-hmm. not pay attention to Iolanta, and here appears the question, who is more blind? Those people or Iolanta, who perfectly see by her heart and by her soul? And regarding this famous duet of Iolanta and Vaudemont, when Vaudemont says, look, you cannot see the sun and the light, to sing glory to the God, and she answers, "No, you have mistaken. I do not need ni sun no light to sing the glory to the God. I do it by my soul." When he tries to explain her what means red and white, she doesn't understand. She even do not know these words. You know, during the rehearsal period, I rewrote lyrics of Vaudemont and added some strange letters. So he pronounced some, for example, not red, but grad. Mm-hmm. And the singer of Iolanta, she said, what's he singing about? And it was exactly the reaction of real Iolanta, because she has never heard these words, so she doesn't understand what the sense is. For her, it doesn't mean anything. She is self-sufficient.
Yeah, it's a classical way in all drama history. I mean, that the blind person is actually the one who sees the reality.
In King Lear or something, right?
Exactly. Yeah. So that's very, very traditional. Yeah. We play Iolanta on its own, or on her own. I mean, usually it's paired with another piece. As you have already said, it was from the beginning, Nutcracker and Iolanta together. But some people have asked me, why are you doing only Iolanta? Why are you not doing something else with it? What can you say? Pros and cons about playing it on its own and playing it together with another piece?
Well, in Helicon we played it with intermission.
Yes.
So it consists of two parts. Before arrival of Robert and Vaudemont, and the second go until the end, and actually it works pretty well. But I think that Iolanta is a masterpiece which is enough impressive for one evening. And when you compare it to some other operas, you might lose, because the impression of this chef d'oeuvre of Tchaikovsky is 100% self-sufficient, and you may spoil it a little bit with the second part. I did not talk about Nutcracker, because it is completely different.
Well, the audiences are different these days. I mean, it would be very interesting to do them together these days, but I think the audiences have become a bit separated. There's an opera audience and there's a ballet audience, but to actually put it together would be, I'd love to do that someday. Yeah. That would be fun. Yeah. But I think actually, especially considering we're just coming back from the pandemic, having an hour and a half opera is actually perfect, because at this point we didn't know, you know, what the rules would be when we open. And actually some theaters like to do shorter performances just to be on the safe side, and this is a perfect thing to do. Also, we have to make some adjustments because we weren't sure how big the orchestra could be. So we had a very clever guy make a reorchestration, which means that some of the instruments were taken out and were rewritten for other instruments in the wind section mostly. The strings are a little smaller than they would be usually, but it's a very good arrangement and it covers all the notes. Everything is played. It's just that sometimes, you know, bassoons would be playing horn parts or you know, an oboe note would be played by a trumpet or something, just because at that point they weren't sure how many people could actually be in the orchestra pit, what was allowed. So I think it's a very clever thing they did, and I think it's a perfect length coming right back from the pandemic. I think it worked out very well, and certainly the piece stands on its own, I think, definitely, whether you do it with an intermission or don't do it with an intermission. It's a very satisfying piece of work.
I have one last question. I mean, this opera is about senses, and Iolanta, she has lost one of her senses, the eyes. So what sense? I mean, there are hearing, seeing, feeling, tasting, smelling. Yeah, those are the five. So which one would you think would be the hardest to lose?
Well, for a musician, it's obvious.
Yeah.
Hearing, of course. But
Yeah, but
Beethoven was okay.
Well, yeah, but
you have to
but
see.
He heard it. He was composing, and he heard it in his head.
Yeah.
That's
yeah. But you have to see the singers and see the musicians when you.
Well, I mean, there have been conductors who've gotten very old who don't see very well anymore. Like Toscanini could barely see anything at the end.
Okay.
But he had everything in his head. It was all memory,
yeah.
And he would, you know, rehearse by memory. And you know, I could conduct a lot of things without, you know, seeing. I could point and
okay,
tell
good.
People.
Okay, good.
But hopefully not for a long time.
And what about you, Sergey?
Well, I would just cite the quotation of Saint-Exupéry in his Little Prince. He says that the most able to see is the heart.
Mm.
You will not be able to see the main thing by your eyes. So the feeling of heart seeing is essential.
Thank you so much. And we are so much looking forward to the performances. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And we wait everybody for our performances here in Royal Opera House. Thanks a lot for inviting us.
Tusen tack.
Tack så mycket.
Tack.